morning, church. Isn't that something that we have actually entered the last stretch of the year? We have entered the last semester, and you can feel fall in the air. Anyways, it is wonderful to be able to gather to worship the Lord. I'm Kofi, and welcome to the Fellowship of Forest Heights Baptist Church. I want to take a moment to extend a special welcome to everyone who is visiting us this morning, especially for the first time. Whether you have joined us just to take a look at what's going on in here today or actually searching out for a permanent place of worship, we are pleased to have you with us. To know more about us, I encourage you to go on our website, FHBCofmd.org, or Google Forest Heights Baptist Church of Maryland. We love to stay in touch with you, so I invite you to fill out a contact us card on the website. You may write your name, your email address, or your phone number on there, or any questions that you may have. You can also share more about yourself if you so desire to. While on the website, if you have a prayer request, please do not hesitate to fill out a prayer request form. We would love to pray for you. So it is our encouragement to you to make use of this opportunity to allow us to serve you in this way. Enjoy the rest of the worship time with us, and may the Lord bless you. Amen.
Thank you, Kofi. Good morning, everyone. Praise the Lord. I'm going to give you the announcements for the week, but the first order of business right now is we need to remember to lift up our pastor, Reverend William Jones, in prayer, as he has is going to have hip surgery on Tuesday. Oh, we're going to pray in the name of Jesus that everything will be a success, and every doctor, nurse, and whoever touches him will be touched by the Spirit of the God, of the Lord, and transferred to him. So we're going to lift him up. Wednesday Bible study, we have a treat. We will be having a missionary from the International Mission Board, Nathaniel Hooten, join us to give us some information on missions, something that we've not done on Wednesday Bible study in a while. But be tuned in at 7 o'clock on Wednesday for that. He's just a new father. Him and his baby they're in Virginia, and his wife, but they can't travel right now. So just pray for Mr. Hooten and his wife and their baby that they will eventually get to make it home safely. Those ladies who plan to join me for tea on October the 31st, please let me know today after service or give me a call and let me know if you plan to attend the tea. I'm wrapping up all that I need to do, so if you plan to attend, please let me know today. Offerings and giving is still going on as usual on Wednesdays from 12 to 1 and Saturday 10 to 12. And those are the announcements that we have for the week. Everybody have a safe and blessed week.
Good morning. Welcome to our call. This morning is going to come from Proverbs, two verses, starting out in chapter 1 of Proverbs, verse 7. It says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fool despises wisdom and instruction." We go to chapter 3. It says, in verse 13, "Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding." So, hey, don't be that fool, but be the happy man who gains wisdom knowledge. Amen? Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come understanding that the knowledge of wisdom, dear Heavenly, first start with you, dear Heavenly Father, and that we should get that wisdom, dear Heavenly Father, and be the happy man who gains that understanding. and not be the one who despises wisdom. It's in Jesus' name that I pray this prayer. Amen.
Oh, good. This is a good song the guy is saying. This is a good song. I don't know why they didn't play this one last week.
The Lord. Good morning, everyone. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this morning. It is a pleasure to bring you the Word of God. There's a couple of things I'd like to share with you today, and one of them is a very special thing. It was a very special greeting or thanks that I received this morning, my wife and I, from the Bible study from Miss Gray's, an honor, if you will. And I just want to say thank you very much because of our marriage. And then the second thing is, I don't know who that group was that was singing, but I sure like to hear those rascals again. Bless your heart. I'm looking forward to today's word. As I prepare for that, I did quite a bit of research, and I wanted to talk to you about a particular title. And it's somewhat long, so I'm going to have to explain it later on, but I'll read it first, and then I'm going to go into our scripture. Our scripture for this morning, the title this morning is, We Want the Right Thing, but Doing the Wrong Thing to Get It. We want the right thing, but we're doing the wrong thing to get it. And the scripture this morning is in Acts chapter 2, verses 32 through 38. And I'm reading from the NASB, New American Standard Bible. Amen. So I'm asking that you would read along with me as I would read aloud. Beginning at verse 32, it says, "This Jesus God has raised up, on which we are all witness. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now, which you know, now see, amen, now see and hear. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself," and it's quotes, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make you your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let all that, all the house of Israel know now, now assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you sacrificed, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men of brothers, brethren, what shall we do?" Amen. The word of God this morning, again, is coming out of Acts chapter 2, verses 32 through 38. And in this title that I had brought to you this morning, we want to the right thing, but we are doing the wrong thing to get it. So let me take just a few seconds and kind of explain that in a more simplified way. Let's say that we are in college right now, and we're seeking a particular degree. And there's certain things that you have to do in order to get that degree. You have to come to class, first of all. You have to bring certain books to get there so that you can read about the topic that you're going to talk about. But then instead of doing those basic things, what you end up doing is skipping class. And you're doing the wrong thing. You might want that degree, but you're doing the wrong things to get it. So I try to make that more simplified in the sense of understanding that particular title for today. So now, as we talk about the scriptures today in verses 32 to 38 in Acts chapter 2, there's some things that happened prior to that brought us to this particular scripture. So let me share a little bit about the story, and I ask that you would go back at some point and read that yourself. But in this particular scripture, we find that Peter was going to be preaching. But prior to his preaching, they were at the Pentecost. And at the beginning of the Pentecost, there was a strong wind that came through, and it blew over all the men that were there. And in that wind, what happened was they saw tongues that looked like fire, and they were split. If you watch fire sometime as it's crackling, and you see that the fire splits in two, and you see a piece of fire coming this way and fire going that way, they're talking about the tongues that split. Those tongues then touched those men. It was the Holy Spirit. It says in the word there prior to that, it says that he that ascended descended upon them while they were sitting there. Amen. It shocked them. They didn't know what to expect. They were astonished, the word said. And so as they were sitting there, they didn't know what happened. But then you find out that there was something that took place, that all of those men that were sitting there, they all of a sudden heard someone speaking. Well, as we read the scriptures, we're finding that Peter stood up amongst all the men when those things took place. And when that happened, he said, "Men, I need your attention. I need to be able to speak to you right now." You see, Luke is speaking about those apostles in Acts and things that happened to these men. And so at that time, he said, "Let me speak. I need to talk to all of you." He got their attention now. And here we come to verse 34, where David, where Peter is talking about David in the sense of what he had made statements about. So let's go to verse 32, I'm sorry. And it says this, it says, this Jesus God has raised up, of which are, which we are all witnesses. In other words, they had witnessed at some point that this was the Jesus that died and the one who was raised, that he raised again, and he was now sits on the right hand of the Father. They witnessed the fact that he died, and they saw him, those that saw him, they saw him again here on earth. And they witnessed that. And Peter's making sure that some of these men that were there, that they understood that they had witnessed that. Lord have mercy. That's the same God that said. And so now they witnessed that. So he goes on. It says here in Ephesians 1:20, it says this, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heaven places. King James Version, that's what it says. And it's confirming what Peter is talking about in a different book. Sometimes I shared with you that sometimes you have to bounce the truth against the truth. So in other words, you're reading scripture to bounce that, to make sure that what's being said is being said. God does not fool with the words, amen? What he says is truth, and you can prove it with another scripture. And that's what happens here. So then we go to verse 33. I'm going to slow myself down some. I get excited too quick sometimes when I be preaching the word, but I need to slow down just a tad. So listen to what it says in verse 33. It says, therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out his, this which you now see and hear. Amen. In other words, what they saw, what they heard was that word, that wind that came through. Whoosh. And when that wind came through, they saw the fire. They saw this tongue of the fire that looks like a split tongue. And they said, when he's saying there that those things are true, they witnessed those things. They actually saw those things. And so now these guys, these men are sitting there, even though they may not understood it at that time, it truly happened. They witnessed it. There were these men from all over the place, all over the city, all over the towns, all over the country. They come from different locations. And we'll find out a little more about them very shortly. The early preachers preached the resurrection. But Peter said, you witnessed it. Amen. You see, some of us, we read about it, but now we found that some that were there that actually witnessed what he's talking about. That resurrection wasn't something that was taken, that wasn't taken for granted. There were those that actually witnessed the fact that Jesus had risen from the dead. Amen. I can't imagine how some of them may feel right now that Peter is bringing that back to their attention and helping them to understand that what they're witnessing now is true. So he's helping them to understand that you pay attention to what's going on around you. You might understand what it is that you're after, but you might be going about it the wrong way. Listen to what it says in verse 34. It says, for David did not ascend into the heaven. But he says himself, quote, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. Amen. The Lord said to my Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He's talking about his Lord. And then he's talking about his God that had his Son to sit on his right hand side. See, they're all one, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so David is making sure they understand that he indeed was sitting on the right hand of the Father. Listen to this. It says, this verse is better explained in verse 229. I want you to write that down so that you can go back at a different time and look at that particular verse. That's in Acts verse 229, okay? Now, listen to this. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the partridge David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulchre is with us unto this day. Let me go back. I want to read that again. In verse 29, it says this: Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the partridge, David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. And so what he's doing is confirming the fact that Jesus died, and where he died, his sepulcher is still there today as a witness to all of us. It's something that's still there that you don't have to worry about. If you don't believe it, they want you to see. He wants to say to them, go back and see it, because it's there. It hasn't gone. It's there to this day. And so Peter is continuing to go on and talking about the things that David had said to make it what he was saying as he was preaching, those things clear to them and helping them to understand that what he's saying is true. We're going after what we want, but are we doing it the right way? We're going to get to that thought again. In verse 35, it says this. It says, till I make your enemies your footstool. Well, I'm going to tarry here for a second because I need to. That's a very short verse there. And I always looked at that in a different way than what I have studied this past week in reference to the understanding of what that truly means. Listen to this. When you're talking about the footstool, it says a low support for the feet of a royal person. That's interesting. Right now, I might consider myself a royal person. I put my foot up on the stool sometime to get my feet washed. But that's not what they're talking about. Here at this particular time, they're talking about a step stool being for a royal person. But when this word is used in the Bible, symbolically, it means the exalted position of God or Jesus over human beings or over earth itself. Amen. I want you to write down Isaiah 66 and 1. Now, let me explain some things right here before I go forth with that. I want us to understand that what God is saying to us, what the word is saying to us, Peter is trying to make plain to us, is that that step stool is not for us to put that person up under our feet and for us to walk all over them any way that we feel like, because they are our enemy. That is God's responsibility. He says here that God and Jesus does that, not us. So when they go under the foot, they're going under God's foot, his control. He's the one that has the control, not us. So anything that's going to be done to them will be done by God. He will put them under his footstool. Let him handle those situations, not us. If we take it upon ourselves to do that and put somebody under our foot, we're going to do it the wrong way. So I'm saying to you, don't go after that person and think that what you're going to do and put them under your footstool in the sense of you walking all over them, amen, and thinking that you are in control, you are not in control, amen. Prayerfully, Peter is making that plain to each of us that we understand that that footstool belongs to God and he will deal with those persons himself. Listen to what it says in Isaiah 66:1. It says, thus saith the Lord, the heavens is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Amen. Where is the house that ye built unto me? And where is the place of my rest? Amen. One more time. Listen to what it says now. I want to make sure we understand that that footstool belongs to God and it's in his control. And you'll find this in Isaiah 66:1. It says this, thus saith the Lord, the earth, the heavens is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Amen. Where is the house that we built unto me? And where is the place of my rest? See, so it's making it plain there. Isaiah is making it plain in a different way as we have already read that particular scripture and making it plain that God is saying that the footstool is his and that's under him. The earth and everything else, all the humans is under him. So see, we don't have that kind of control to walk on anybody. We might think that we have control, or some people might think that they have control, but the earth is God's. Amen? The word says that, not William. That's the word of God that says that the earth is his and everything that is within it. Amen. Mm-hmm. We fall under his footstool. It doesn't belong to us. Thank you, Lord. Now we understand that particular scripture. Let's go on and hear what Peter was saying to us in these verses today. In verse 36, it says this. It says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know now assuredly that God has made this Jesus, who you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Powerful words there. If Peter's talking to the group of men that are there, and he's saying these things, listen to what it says one more time. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know now assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Savior. Now he's saying that to them, that who you crucified. You see, what it is it goes back to the saying now, what you want to do, you are going about it the wrong way to get it. He told them that they're the ones that crucified him. They're the ones that caused this to happen. They wanted the Messiah is what they wanted. And when the Messiah was there, they went about it the wrong way and they crucified him is what happened. Now you understand that long sentence that I gave you for a title today. What we want and how we go about getting it is two different things. We're doing it the wrong way. We should be after our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And if you're after him, you need to go after him the right way. That's the idea. Not the things that we want in life. Those things should not come first in our lives. The God that we serve ought to be the one that we seek. And those that don't know him need to come to know him and understand that they need him in their life first. And then all those other things that we go after will then fall in place. Amen. Jesus is God as well anointed Messiah. And they were the ones who caused him his death. And Romans 1:4 says this, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Yeah. See, all the power is in his hand. He was raised from the dead. All power, he says, is in his hand. And so now Peter is going towards the end, as we see it here in the verse, the last verse that I have for today, to tie things together so we can understand the whole picture now. Listen to what it says in verse 37. It says, now when they heard this, they were cut to their heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Yeah. You see, they were pricked. When he told them, when Peter made it plain to them that they were the ones that caused his death, they were the ones that caused him to be crucified. They were pricked. They were stuck. They were pierced. Their hearts hurt. They hurt because now they truly understand what Peter is saying, that they had caused his death. Yes, that was truly the Messiah. What caused them to believe it? The fact that he was raised from the dead. And then they turn around and ask the question, what must we do? How can we correct this thing that we did? What is it that we can do to correct it? Is it something that we can do to undo what we've done? What is it that we can do? Their hearts are hurting now. They recognize the fact that they're the ones that made the mistake. Have you ever made a mistake and recognized the fact that you have made that mistake? What has it done to your heart when that happens? It pricked them. It made them uncomfortable. Now they want to make the correction, so they ask the question, what must we do? I'm glad that they asked that question, because Peter then made it plain to them what they must do. Listen to what Peter says to them. As we continue, it says, Peter listened. Peter's listeners were cut. They were pricked. It pierced them and had a intense spiritual conviction that they killed their Messiah. It pricked them. It hurt them. It was a conviction that came upon them spiritually to help them to understand what was happening to them. You remember in the beginning when I was talking about those tongues, those fiery tongues, the Spirit of God came down upon them while all those men were sitting there. And now that Spirit helped them to understand that what they did, they caused the death, and now it pricked them. They understand. It pierced them. They realized that what they did was wrong. And then in verse 38, it ties everything together for us here. Listen to what it says. It says, then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. You see, what must we do? So he answers that question. He said, Peter says this to them. He says, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah. See, they needed to repent. They needed to turn around from their wicked ways. 360 completely and not do those things anymore. So when you repent, you're turning away from those things in which you used to do. You ask for forgiveness of those things. God will forgive you, but you must ask. And then completely turn around and give those things to him. Listen to this. If they did not repent, otherwise they would not experience true conversion. If we don't repent, if we don't turn around from our wicked ways, we don't get that understanding that we're supposed to have with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The relationship that we ought to have with him, we don't get that if we don't repent. It has to be truly from your heart that you repent and turn from your wicked ways, whatever it is that you're doing. Now, I'm not going to go over a whole bunch of things that we're doing that's wrong, because it applies to all of us, because each of us falls short every day of the Word of God. It goes on, and let me just say this. If they did not, or I did that, but I'm sorry, repent. This refers to a change of mind and purpose that turns an individual from sin to God. Amen. It's a change of your mind that causes you to turn completely around and turn away from those awful things that we are doing in the sight of God and turn to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what it means. So when they asked the question that they were sitting there and all those men were sitting there, let me share this with you. There were 17 different tongues that was being spoken in the beginning when those men were sitting there. There were 17 different tongues that they heard after that wind blew through. And all of them heard their different tongues, their different languages. And when they did, there were 17 different languages that was being spoken. And so you can imagine all these men sitting there and hearing the language that they did in their own words, realizing that they were the ones that caused the death. They were the ones that wanted the right thing, but they went about it the wrong way to get it. And in the end, we find out that they asked, what can I do to fix this? What do we do? Well, Peter tells them, he says, you turn from your sins. And if you do that, you return back to God, ask him to forgive you and accept you as you are, and he will accept you. My brothers and sisters, it's time for me to close with this particular message today. So I want you to understand and realize and think about what it is that you're doing. And if you're doing or you're going after something, go about it the right way. If you go about it the wrong way, you will pay a price. The price that these men paid at that end, that they were pricked. And the Holy Spirit came upon them and helped them to understand that what they did was wrong. But Peter explained to them in words that they would understand that all they need to do was to repent, ask for forgiveness, and change that mind as it says in the Word, so that they would then accept God and Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for listening to the Word of God today and understanding what that title meant. and how Peter made it plain to us using the other apostles that were there as well and talked about them as well. I ask that you would bow your head with me as I would close us in prayer today. Almighty God, I come humbly to you this day. I thank you for your word, God, that helps us to understand that we might be going after something in our lives, but we may be doing it the wrong way. So, Father, I'm asking that you would touch each of us in a special way as the Holy Spirit went among those men and touched each of them and let them know that what they were doing was wrong. And then they asked the question, what must they do? Peter made it plain to them that they simply needed to change their ways, turn from the wicked ways. And so I'm praying right now, oh God, that you bless someone today. Help them to understand the message, oh God, that you have given them. But this is my prayer in the precious name of your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ, do I pray. Amen. Before we go, there is something I'd like to say to those of you who have not accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. There may be one of you there today who realized that you were going after something the wrong way, and now you realize from the word that was preached today that you need to go after Jesus Christ. And if you do that, I want you to repeat after me and accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Would you bow your head with me and repeat after me? Almighty God, I come humbly to you. I recognize, O God, that I am a sinner, that I have fallen short of your way. I ask, God, that your Son, Jesus, would accept me as I am. Forgive me of my sins, for I do believe that Jesus Christ died for me. He was buried, and as the word says, on that third day he was raised, and now he sits on the right hand of the Father. And so, God, I'm asking that your Son, Jesus, would accept me as I am and save my soul. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with me today, then I asked of you to do one of two things. One, I would love for you to join with us at Forest Heights Baptist Church. If you choose to do that, I would like for you to call us on the telephone at area code 301-839-1166. Again, 301-839-1166. Call that number and give us your name. Leave us your telephone number and an address so that we can get in touch with you. And if you choose to join another church, then I would like for you to go to someone right now in your presence or call someone at that church and let them know that you accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Amen. The heavens is rejoicing because you've done that. Once you've done that, they will lead you to the church that you've gone to and that you have accepted so that you can be baptized as the word says here. And then I want you to study the word of God each day. That's all I have for you today. And I thank you for those of you who joined in with us today. And for those of you who have maybe accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I bless you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I say to us all, go in peace. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Jones.
Amen. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you for that message for life.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing